What's up, everyone? Welcome to the show. I'm Nate, a marketing manager at HubSpot. We got a lot to cover today. First, we're going to talk about why Quibi failed at launching their streaming service. I'm going to share lessons about how I think they could have avoided the failure. Then we're going to talk about brand building. One of the key ingredients to building a brand that people love is to pick an enemy and take a stand against that enemy. And we'll look at why certain brands have decided to boycott ads on Facebook recently. We're also going to be talking about my marketing philosophy and specifically five ideas that I want to share with you to hopefully make you a better marketer. First, let's start with the goal of my channel here. I have a goal that I want to share with you and I want you to sort of know about my goal to help keep me accountable. I want to get 100 subscribers in 2 months. So starting today, as of this recording, which is July 6th, so by September 6, 2020, I should have at least 100 subscribers. As of this recording, I have 13, so still quite a ways to go. How will I get there? Well, as I've discussed in previous videos about goals and systems, basically I'm going to focus on creating a system, which is a process that'll help me get to getting more subscribers. And when you think about getting more subscribers, right, you need to produce more videos. So this is how I'm thinking about it. I want to create highly niche content for marketing students about marketing internships and getting a job in marketing. And you can expect to see a lot more of this content. Well, what does this look like for me? I'll be producing 2 videos per week for the next 3 months, targeting highly relevant search terms on YouTube and Google. So hopefully this will work. I'm really excited for this journey. And come along, subscribe to help me hit that goal. So next, let's talk about my marketing philosophy and the 4 ideas that I want to share with you to be a better marketer. And I'm going to use an example of Sony PlayStation when they launched the PlayStation 4. The first idea here is that the more you understand your target customer, the better of a marketer you'll become. As you know, marketing is about connecting a product or service or your business with an end user, with your prospect, with your customer, right? It's connecting your business to the end user. So the more you understand what makes your end user tick, what problems they have, what aspirations they have, where they spend their time, etc., the better you'll do. You'll write better copy, you'll create a better product, you'll do a lot better for them. For example, looking at Sony here, at the Electronic Entertainment Expo, or E3, in 2013, Sony announced the new PlayStation 4. Sony's biggest competitor, Microsoft, had just announced the Xbox One, showing games targeting a broad consumer. So for example, Microsoft presented the Xbox One with an emphasis on TV connectivity and other media features aside from gaming, like TV sports, which was badly received by their fans. Plus, the console was weaker than the PS4, would need an internet connection to work as a gaming machine, and wouldn't accept used copies of games unless Microsoft allowed the games to be resold on their consoles. Oh, and also Kinect, which was their 3D camera, had to be connected to the Xbox One at all times. Fans hated all of this, and even after Microsoft reversed most of those features, the damage had already been done. So at E3 that year, Sony took advantage of all of Microsoft's mistakes. They knew who their customer would be, which are gamers. When Sony announced the PlayStation 4, they focused on what their customer base wants, and that's exclusive AAA games, game sharing, and a good price point. Sony focused on sharing games because they knew that gamers were watching closely for that. During their conference, they announced that PlayStation 4 would accept used games, wouldn't need an internet connection to work, and would be $100 cheaper than the Xbox One at $399. After all this, the pre-order ratio for PlayStation 4 versus Xbox One was 2-1. This didn't change in 7 years. And that's when Sony really won the 8th generation of consoles. Check out this crowd reaction to a video of the conference.
In addition to creating an amazing library of new titles on PlayStation 4, we're equally focused on delivering what gamers want most without imposing restrictions or devaluing their PS4 purchases. For instance, PlayStation 4 won't impose any new restrictions on the use of PS4 gamers. When a gamer buys a PS4 disc, they have the rights to use that copy of the game. They can trade in the game at retail, sell it to another person, lend it to a friend, or keep it forever.
The second marketing philosophy is, if you understand the customer, you can contribute to creating a world-class product. Great marketing comes from a great product. If the product sucks, no amount of world-class marketing can redeem it. Marketing can help make a good product great, but it'll never make a bad product good. For example, when we think about Microsoft and the Xbox One in 2013, it didn't meet the standards of most gamers to justify the high price of $499. Microsoft could throw advertising dollars at it, but the product needed to be changed for those ad dollars to be effective. For example, Microsoft then, after E3, had reversed the Xbox One's online check and use games policy, following their fans backlashing that policy. You had to always be connected to Microsoft servers to run your games and couldn't lend games to anyone. Microsoft lifted those restrictions to make the product better for their customers. Number three, at the same time, a great product does not mean that the product will market itself. The field of dreams problem is real. Build it and they will come is a myth. Creating a product people want is necessary, but it's not enough. You need to tell people about it. You need to get it in front of your target market. Great products need differentiated distribution strategies to succeed. This means having exclusive ways to amplify your product's voice that your competitors may not have access to. You may need to test different channels to see which ones provide the most efficient growth. And lastly, once you understand your customer and create a world-class product for them, your job as a marketer is to turn your customers into advocates. This is called the flywheel effect. Basically, once you have a world-class product and your customers are happy, then your customers may start referring other people or talking about you online. This is typically known as word of mouth marketing, and it's very hard to achieve with new products. The hack here is to develop products that customers love so that they end up talking about your product to their friends. In the case of Sony, the PlayStation 4 got word of mouth spread because the PlayStation 4 was doing so many things right. Gamers were telling their friends to get the PlayStation 4, and some Xbox fans converted over to Sony. That's why the Sony PlayStation 4 at the time sold two consoles to every console that Microsoft sold. It was a very interesting time in the gaming industry. So to recap, understand your target customer base. Create a product that they love. Find differentiated distribution channels. And turn your fans into advocates. The theme that ties everything together simply comes from making your customers happy. Provide them a great customer experience, and they can provide you even more in the long run. Now let's get into why Quibi failed. For those of you who don't know, Quibi is an entertainment streaming service. The founder, Jeffrey Katzenberg, as we talked about in the second episode, blamed their failure on the coronavirus. But if you think about it, during this time, more people would want to watch content online. About 80% of US consumers now subscribe to at least one paid streaming service, which is up from 73% in the pre-COVID survey. This is interesting because if you blame a failed streaming service product on the coronavirus, it doesn't make sense with what the data is showing us. Streaming, in fact, has increased. In episode 2, we covered that one of the reasons why Quibi failed was because it didn't start off niche. For a company spending millions of advertising dollars, this is extremely dangerous because you don't have traction with any customer segment yet. They were literally buying million-dollar Super Bowl ads to the general US population without having yet gained traction among a consumer base. When you start off niche, you can understand a specific customer segment better than anyone else and then grow from there. If you think about the marketing philosophy of getting to know your customer, that's where that comes in. If you start off niche, you can really get to know that small audience segment. But if you start off broad, it's sort of hard to please everyone. It's hard to be everything to everyone. For example, Quibi could have started off as the horror streaming service. I like horror as a genre because you can produce content relatively with cheap budgets. Also, you don't necessarily relate the genre horror with Netflix or Hulu or HBO. No major streaming service owns the horror genre in the mind of consumers, in my opinion. Instead, Quibi decided to produce content for the masses, spending literally millions of dollars on original content. Okay, so Quibi has all this original content from some of the best producers and creators in the world. You think that it would do well, right? Well, actually, that's not the case. Consumers wondered why they had subscribed to Quibi for $4.99 a month with ads and $7.99 without. Netflix, to put it in perspective, Netflix charges $8.99 for the basic plan per month, which is ad-free, and Hulu charges $5.99 a month for its ad-supported plan. For Quibi to charge that much for very limited content compared to Hulu and Netflix, consumers wondered why Quibi would be better. Why would they even want to buy Quibi as a service? Did you buy Quibi? Probably not, right? I know I didn't. I didn't even want to try the trial because it wasn't worth it. Honestly, I don't watch a lot of TV, but that's for another discussion. For marketers, we call this value proposition. What differentiates your product from other competing products, and why would consumers care? Value props are sort of the key to understanding how you can communicate your product externally and note its distinctiveness in the market. They should be distinctive, so they're not replicable by competitors. They should be measurable, so quantified in monetary terms, and they should be sustainable for the long term. So you should be able to own this value prop for a while. How do you deliver a strong value prop? First, you need to understand your customers. Invest time and effort to understand your customers and identify their unique requirements and preferences. Then you need to substantiate your value claims. Having a lower price can't really cut it. Back up this claim in accessible, persuasive language that describes the differences between your offerings and rivals' offerings, and explain how those differences translate into monetary worth for your customers. This typically happens primarily with B2B companies because at the end of the day, B2B, one of the main values is the benefit of cost savings. So saving money if you go to a certain service over another. For consumer products, this is not necessarily the case all the time, especially with entertainment products. The third thing is to document value delivered. Understand why customers prefer your product and service and use the language that they use in your marketing. That's where copywriting comes in, and it's actually very helpful to use certain terms that your customers use when describing how your product or service is differentiated in the market. But watch out for some of the common traps when people think about creating value props. Be careful of talking about advantages that customers don't actually care about. So for Quibi, I think the main point of differentiation was the users can rotate their screens to see media vertically. Their headline reads on their website, "Watch movie quality shows designed for your phone." However, do you as a potential user actually care about this? Because how is this actually different from watching Netflix on your phone or watching any streaming service on your phone? At the end of the day, most consumers don't care about the vertical media viewing advantage. It's not really a value prop. It's only a benefit. Without a clear understanding of customers' requirements and preferences and what it's worth to fulfill them, you may stress value props in this case that deliver relatively little value to your target customer. Consumers don't care enough about short video formats for the phone when they can get the value on other platforms too. It's not differentiated for Quibi in this case. So to summarize, base your value prop on a few elements that matter most to your target customers, demonstrate the value of this superior performance, and communicate it in a way that conveys a sophisticated understanding of your customers' priorities. In this case, Quibi failed because it didn't understand really how it was differentiated among all other video streaming services. And if it was to say that the differentiation was content in short form bites and in a vertical media viewing experience, I'm not sure that consumers would agree that that differentiation is enough to get them to convert and buy the Quibi subscription. Okay, now let's talk about some news recently. A bunch of companies are stopping ads on Facebook and Instagram to protest Facebook's lackluster hate speech policies. Clothing brand Patagonia, coffee house Starbucks, household products giant Unilever, and soft drink behemoth Coca-Cola were just some of the big name businesses they announced they'd be pulling 1 to 6 months of advertising spend from Facebook's platform. If you don't know, Facebook owns Instagram, which is another large ad platform. So they're pulling ad spend from both Facebook and Instagram ads. They might be hoping the losses will force Facebook to take further action or else risk losing really the revenue from the ads and also some attention from investors. Facebook promised last week to ban both hate speech in ads and label any posts that violate those policies. But the company still didn't commit to actually removing posts altogether, which may have been the last straw for organizations that have argued against Facebook's lack of doing anything to halt the spread of bigotry. Over 750 companies have joined as of Friday before July 4th. Facebook is unlikely to take a beating because only 6% of Facebook's 2019 ad revenue came from its top 100 biggest advertisers. So without a real big mass movement among small to medium-sized businesses, Facebook's bottom line will likely come out fine. Brands are taking a stand against hate speech and bigotry in advertisements, which is a moral good and noble cause. Brands who take a stand are doing so to set an example that these sort of ads shouldn't be shown on Facebook. You'll notice this happen with some of the most popular brands. They take a stand against something. For many brands, it's usually them taking a stand against an enemy. Like Patagonia, for example, they stand against environmental destruction. Or Ben & Jerry's, they stand against racial injustice. In 2015, Nielsen, which is a big media research company, published its annual Global Corporate Sustainability Report. It indicated that globally, 73% of millennials are willing to spend more on a product if it comes from a sustainable brand. Another study in 2017 found that 87% of Americans will purchase a product because a company advocated for issues they cared about. And millennials are more likely than any other generation to research the issues a company supports and the extent to which the company actually contributes. Think about your purchases. Do you try to align your purchases from brands that you think support a good cause? Does this influence your purchasing behavior? For me, I love Patagonia. Not only is Patagonia's customer service amazing and their products are great, but I know that when I buy from Patagonia, I'm helping to support environmentally friendly causes that I really care about. To me, this is better than buying from a brand with a similar product line that doesn't really support a good cause like this. So I'd rather put my dollars to Patagonia. These boycotts against Facebook represent brands backing up their talk with action. And while they're unlikely to reshape Facebook, these boycott dollars do have the potential to help revitalize a struggling news publishing ecosystem. What do you think about these boycotts against Facebook? Let me know in the comments below. Well, that's it for today's episode. I hope you enjoyed it. Please be sure to subscribe for future episodes. I'm going to talk about marketing internships and how you can get an internship or job in marketing and start creating content more around that niche, along with news that I'll be covering throughout the week. So stay tuned for that. Thank you so much. Peace out.